These are four of the greatest gardens in Britain. Gravetye Manor, Ashwood, Great Dixter and Gresgarth Hall. Each has its own unique story to tell. It's like entering another world. Join me, Carol Klein, on a journey through the four seasons as I experience a year in their lives.
I wish you could smell the perfume.
Meet the people who look after them.
It's a bit like falling in love. You can't actually...
help it.
No.
Joyous, isn't it?
I think it's the best time of the year.
Unearth the secrets of how they evolve.
Chris has to be the bee.
Do you have to say bzzz while you're doing it?
Reflect on their magnificent designs and celebrate the plants that make each so special. Carefully colour-coordinated, these borders are at their absolute zenith. These are great British gardens.
I can't wait. Can you?
Great Dixter is one of Britain's most iconic gardens. It was the lifelong home of Christopher Lloyd, a revolutionary gardener who tore up the horticultural rule book.
This magnificent house and its 6 acres of garden have become a horticultural mecca for garden lovers all over the world. It was more than 100 years ago that the Lloyd family bought the property. Later, it was passed on to one of the children, Christopher Lloyd, known as Christo. He became one of the most influential gardeners of the 20th century.
Christo also insisted that the garden should look breathtaking in every season.
Everywhere you go in Dixter, you're aware of all four seasons of the year. You've got conifers, these wonderful yews, topiary, that are going to look brilliant all through the winter, as will the heads of this grass. That'll be at its very best in the autumn. And you know that during the summer, all these herbaceous perennials are just going to zoom into action, and the whole place will be colour, an absolute kaleidoscope. Glorious euphorbias, daffodils with the most brilliant yellow flowers. It just says, spring is here.
Christopher Lloyd was a celebrated gardening writer. His numerous articles and books, based on his experience at Great Dixter, have made it one of the most written about gardens and one of the most loved.
I'm so thrilled to be here. I can remember the very, very first time I came. It must be more than 30 years ago. And once you've been, you've got to keep coming back. Everybody does. I think this garden, it has such energy and such dynamism. And immediately you just taken over by the magic of the place. You're cast under its spell.
This enchanting garden covers 6 acres. The old house was extended by the famous architect Edwin Lutyens, who also laid out the garden, which wraps around the house on all sides. There are 19 different areas. Some, such as the front and orchard meadows, are very natural wildflower areas, but these are interspersed with more traditional, formal ones, such as the high garden, the peacock garden, and the topiary lawn. To the right of the entrance is the barn garden, with its octagonal pool, which leads through to the secluded wall garden. But one of the garden's most remarkable features is the long border at the rear of the house. 90 metres in length, its carefully crafted design is imitated throughout the world. There are There are so many wonderful things to see here, but I want to begin my year-long journey in the orchard meadow at the back of the house. Nothing epitomises spring as much as the wildflowers that grow here. At this time of year, spring crocuses are popping up everywhere, and hiding amongst them is one of my favourite plants.
So this is Fritillaria meleagris, commonly called a snake's head fritilla, and you can see why. Because if you look at the buds everywhere, they're just like these little serpentine heads. And then they open into this beautiful bell. And a lot of them are checkered. And it's almost looks hand-painted. Right in front of it is this purple orchid. These beautiful spotted leaves. Dactylorhiza, one of our native orchids, that will make these big purple spikes. And then there's cow parsley, and there are buttercups, there's sorrel. The more plants you have, the more insects you get, the more birds come, the more small mammals, and the whole thing just works together beautifully. And what's more, it doesn't just work for this moment in spring, although it's probably at its most beautiful right now. There's this huge succession that continues right the way through the year. At no time would you come into this meadow and not find something of interest.
Succession planting, or planning so that things follow on one after the other, is a principle that's employed throughout the estate. I'm meeting up with head gardener and my friend Fergus Garrett, who's showing me an example of succession planting in the barn garden.
Look how good those phyllodendron leaves are, just coming up, taking over from everything else.
And later on, that's going to be way up here, isn't it?
Yes. See, the great thing about this is the leaves look so good for such a long time. They go right the way up, and then it'll flower with its mauve flowers. Yeah. Running through here, there's Lady Smock as well. That's giving us a bit of a show.
Although these plants are just appearing now, they'll soon bloom, then fade and be replaced by fresh ones.
How do you work this out, though? I mean, do you plan it all out or do you just experiment all the time?
Well, it's about being observant and looking at the empty spaces. So you're taking plants of different seasons, putting them together, as long as they will live happily together, you get a nice long season from a patch of ground. It's not necessarily labour-intensive at all, because these are fixed layers that just come up and down.
Come the summertime, the barn garden will be a riot of colour. Later, in the autumn, a whole different group of plants will take over.
So the more you look, it's almost like a calendar. There's something here for every month, isn't there?
Yes.
Great Dixter isn't just packed with fascinating plants. There are so many different areas to explore. And I'm looking forward to seeing how they all develop throughout the year. It's spring at Great Dixter, the birthplace and lifelong home of the late Christopher Lloyd. It's one of Britain's greatest gardens. It's a garden famed for innovation and experiment, and the large community of students, staff and volunteers who work here are dedicated to ensuring it looks glorious in every season. In the barn garden, Fergus wants to try something new.
Cow, there it is, you see.
What a monster!
Oh, it's great, isn't it?
So what is it?
It's Crinum paulii album. And I want to put it in the pond.
I mean, people think that this is a dry-loving plant, don't they? But I can remember Christo writing about seeing this in Malawi.
Yeah. He'd seen it in a wet ditch there or on a swampy ground. And then he started sinking it into the horse pond.
Yeah.
And people were amazed that he was doing that. He thought he was completely crazy, but he wasn't, because he'd seen it in the wild.
Exactly.
But because it's slightly uneven there, I think we'll put it on its side and chop a bit of the soil off the bottom. See if we can roll it on there.
Let's bring this.
That's it. Guys, do you want to come over?
Have you finished your tea?
Luckily, a few willing helpers are on hand.
Yeah, keep it low.
The few years ago, people might have thought Christo's ideas were a bit eccentric. But crinums are known as a swamp lily, so I think it'll be a wonderful addition to the pond. I hope its other residents agree.
That's great.
It really is. It even looks at home.
Just fingers crossed it grows now.
Christo was known for his love of colour. And he himself was flamboyant. He was certainly no shrinking violet.
He loved life, he loved people, he loved exciting people. I loved him to bits. He was part of my family. He was just, we had a really good relationship, and he was like a father figure, a grandfather figure. He was
a brilliant
friend, yeah. You know, and he was so vibrant.
And even when he was all poshed up,
oh, he always used to wear
those gorgeous coloured shirt.
And he used to say, "Oh, Amanda, you know, I've got a blue shirt, I've got a purple one. I've got a two-tone one that sparkles. I've got a yellow one, but I haven't got a yellow one with black stripes, rather like a beak." And now, even now, when I go and I see a yellow shirt with black buttons, I think Christo would have loved that. But I did a lecture once where I showed his shirts, and they were all pinks and oranges and yellows all mixed. And then I showed the blonde border. And I thought, actually, it's the same colours. He gardened in the colours that he loved, and he wore the colours that he loved.
Using daring colour was just one of the many ways in which Christo liked to experiment. And it's this sense of liberation and adventure that still lives on in this garden today. Great Dixter in spring has been a magical experience. It's a garden that's constantly changing, and in just a few more months, it will entirely transform again. I'll be back just as the garden bursts into its full summer glory. Summer is the most popular time for visitors at Great Dixter, and it's easy to see why. This is a garden that doesn't just change from season to season, but also from year to year. But every year, there's one feature that everyone has to see. This is the world-renowned Great Dixter Long Border. It's more than 300 feet long. 15 feet wide. It's one of the deepest borders I've ever come across. When the long border was originally laid out, the taste of the day dictated that it should feature only traditional herbaceous flowering plants. No shrubs, no bulbs, and certainly no trees. And all arranged in a very regimented fashion. But Christo had other ideas. This is no herbaceous border. This is a true mixed border. Take this phlox, for example. Here they're using great big swathes, so they lilt through the border instead of being in clumps, every so often and very symmetrically arranged. But then there are plants like this, this agastache, which insects love and adore. Christo is a great entomologist, and Fergus and his crew have carried that interest on. The garden is so wildlife friendly, and this is a perfect example. Everywhere you look, there are plants that you wouldn't expect to see here. Great big grasses, fluffy artemisias, towering over everything else. I think what Christo passed on was a message not to do as I do, but to do as you do, to experiment, to enjoy, to appreciate plants and to use them in marvellous, wonderful, imaginative ways. It's so wonderful to be back here in the summer. In the barn garden, everything has erupted with wild abandon. Where once there was the foliage of phalaetrums and ladies' smock was flowering, now there are mallows, salvias and heleniums. In fact, There are so many plants packed into this area. The Old Brunswick fig, which provides a wonderful skeletal backdrop in the spring, is now struggling for the spotlight. And the crinum that Fergus and I planted then is now in flower and doing well. But Fergus can't always be on site, so I'm meeting gardener Michael Factor, who originally came from Germany to study here. I want to find out more about how Christo's passion for year-round colour and interest is continued today. I know that one of the things that Christo and Fergus used to talk about all the time was succession, and this is a really good example of it, isn't it?
It is, yeah. Christo said, succession planting means no bare soil from mid-May right into October. So we always try and have the soil covered with plants, which also helps with our weeds germination because they often need light to germinate. So it's really a benefit for us as well.
Right, and what it means is that there's something of interest, something exciting right the way through, one thing taking over from another.
That's right, it looks good in spring, it looks good in summer, it should look good in the autumn as well. Yeah. This is interesting. There's a rose there with bare stems, yeah. And we've grown this Euphorbia palustris underneath.
I mean, this is an experiment, yes?
Yeah.
And it's just renowned for that.
Yeah, it is, yeah, definitely, yeah. And it might fail, you know, we might fail, but so important if you want to be creative is not to be afraid to fail, as long as you take notes.
Yeah, well, if you don't experiment, you don't go any further, do you?
That's right,
everything
yeah.
just that's stays right. the same. And that's in the spirit of Christo, isn't it?
It is, yeah.
Christo loved sharing his passion and expertise with fellow gardeners and often had students to visit. After his death, Fergus expanded the student community, and now they flock from all over the world to soak up some of the vast pool of knowledge that exists at Great Dixter. And the things they learn here are often slightly unexpected. Michael and I are heading next to the barn garden, into the sheltered wall garden, where some of the students have invited me to join them in a training session. Arrangements of pot plants may not seem particularly avant-garde today, but Christo pioneered using huge displays of them as a way to keep interest and colour wherever it might be needed.
It's very quick and you don't have to be afraid of making mistakes because you can just remove it if it doesn't work.
I think it teaches you about contrast and what kind of colours work well together.
It also meant that Christo could experiment with placing plants side by side that would never normally grow together in the wild. And that's not the only bonus.
Lots of the people who come to visit Dixter, they haven't got gardens this size, but seeing something like this must give people so much inspiration. Because, you know, even if you've got a tiny space, you don't have to grow fiddly little plants, you can grow a whacking big hosta, couldn't you?
Yeah, there's no limit at all.
Finishing touch. And what do you think Fergus is going to say when he comes back?
He will come in at 5 o'clock in the morning and just tweak it around.
Come on, it's beautiful! Yeah. It's lovely. Thanks, guys.
When the garden's hard landscaping was completed in the early 1900s, its crowning glory was the Lutyens-designed formal rose garden. But Christo had no time for fashion or tradition. When he got together with Fergus, they had rose garden revolution in mind. It caused murmurings in the gardening community at the time. And no summer visit here was complete without taking a peek at it.
I'm just short on my pith helmet and my machete. Oh, it's like entering another world. It's utterly wonderful. This is the exotic garden. It used to be the rose garden. There would have been very traditional tea and shrub roses. This is an example of Fergus and Christo's grabbing the
horticultural bull by the horns and changing it totally into this wonderful sort of microcosm of a jungle. Everywhere are plants that you just wouldn't see outside. Huge, great bamboos, enormous grasses, ornate leaf shapes that you don't see anywhere else at all. Around every corner, there are towering bananas. Up here, there's Moussa of Barju, which is the really hardy banana. If you look really carefully, the flowers are getting pollinated by hornets. Most of us have seen them on Mediterranean or Canary Island holidays, but here they are in the heart of East Sussex. Is splendiferous. It's a place that's bursting with creative energy, and it's at this time of year when all those new planting ideas reach fruition. And it's an ongoing process. Everyone can see that it's going to continue in the same direction way into the future. My summer visit may be drawing to a close, but this sensational garden will be no less magnificent when I return. I'm at Great Dixter, the lifelong home of writer Christopher Lloyd, one of Britain's most inspiring gardeners. I've been lucky enough to visit it in both the early spring and in high summer. Now it's autumn, and I'm back to see how fruitful the garden is in this bountiful season. Of course, there are fruit and vegetables to be harvested, but autumn is also a feast for the eyes as we enjoy the last of the warm days and the splendour of the changing leaves. These two little meadow areas with the central path leading up to the front door of Dixter were one of Christo's real favourite places. The trees that are planted here were very carefully chosen. This one is Crataegus prunifolius. It's a New World hawthorn from America. It's got simple single leaves, and at this time of year, when these leaves start to fall, you're really aware of these bunches of bright red berries, almost weighing down the branches. In contrast to the hawthorn, dripping with berries, is a neighbouring espaliered pear, planted by Christo's mother, Daisy. She called it the Dumb Blonde, because although it was beautiful, it rarely bore any fruit. This year, it's only managed to produce a single pear. In the autumn, most of us concentrate our attention on the beautiful foliage of trees, on fruit, on berries. But occasionally, it pays to look downwards. It certainly does here. And you're treated to this glorious display of autumn crocus just poking through the grass and opening these beautiful pale lavender chalices to the sunshine. And if you bend over, there is the most beautiful scent. Dead easy to plant, anybody can do it, but you must make sure that once those flowers have finished, the leaves come up, and you don't touch them with your mower, don't go anywhere near them, because they need all that goodness from the leaves to go back into the ground and to give you a further show next year. Autumn is definitely in full swing here at Great Dixter. And I can't wait to see the changes in the Longvoorde since the summer.
This Longvoorde has really lived up to its reputation. When we were here in the summer, it was ebullient, full of gorgeous colours, loads of flowers. And it's still looking absolutely beautiful, but in a different way. Things have started to change. For a start, it's bigger. Everything has burgeoned. I mean, look at this Cotinus. It's huge. It must have been pruned really, really hard, almost down to the ground. And all this is new growth. It's just shot up, heading for the sky. But within it, there are subtle changes already. Leaves are starting to go reds and oranges. And there are roses still out. Absolutely beautiful, but some of the roses have already started to set hips. There are tagetes here in full flower, almost as many flowers or perhaps even more than there were in the summer. And behind the tagetes, honesty seed heads, transparent and papery. There are the first signs of true autumn. There are all sorts of little hidden corners around Great Dixter that really relate to most people's gardening experience. Things full of ideas that you could actually try yourself at home. This little corner epitomises this time of year. The centrepiece is this cornice. And then there's the grass. This is a millinia, and it's known for these dancing stems with their very open heads. But right now, everything has changed to this delicate biscuit colour. And then this lovely clematis, full of tiny little seed heads, a change in texture. The whole thing is autumn.
Autumn's a good time to see the results of some of the experiments undertaken in the garden. Dahlias like these were a favourite of Christo's. Fergus has been playing around with them.
I think this is an outstanding dahlia.
Here, the red dahlia Dovegrove has been crossed with the white Twinings After Eight, searching for a plant that combines the best qualities of both.
I think the important thing is that the flower faces you, so it doesn't look too sad and droop down. Yeah. I think the flowers rise above the foliage. The foliage is crisp, which is on all of these.
They're beautiful.
Which one's your favourite, then?
This tall. This tall, elegant one. Because it's nothing like me.
Fergus and his team are also staying true to Christo's belief that experiment can go hand in hand with looking after wildlife. It's been part of the Great Dixter philosophy for more than a century. This year, another new idea has caught my eye in the solar garden at the front of the house.
With these oast houses as a backdrop and this lovely little hurdle fence in front, how about this for a wave of colour?
Zinnias are annual plants that only bloom once, usually in the summer. But here they're still looking stunning much later on in the autumn.
This is one of Fergus's many experiments. The whole idea is he wants to prolong the flowering season because there are still loads of insects who need nectar and pollen right the way through the autumn and into the winter. To that end, he's put these zinnias out a couple of months later than he would normally. It's worked really brilliantly well. And it's in the whole spirit of Dixter too, because Christo is a great one for experiment and adventure.
To help support wildlife in the autumn and winter, Christo would often leave buffer zones in the meadows when they were cut. Today, there are nearly 700 different types of insect species living in them. Ecology is just as important to Fergus as it was to Christo. I'm meeting him at the far end of the orchard meadow behind the house, at one of his giant insect hotels.
It looks like a fairy tale cottage.
Yeah, it's a wonderful structure, isn't it?
So what do you think Christo would have made of your giant insect hotels?
I don't know, actually. I think he would have loved it as a structure, and he was interested in wildlife.
But in some ways, you've taken that forward and are doing it much more deliberately.
The picture is just really complex. I think it's important that we don't spray. I think it's important that we've got all this wildish land from the outside that feeds into the ornamental borders. We don't cut down in the autumn. We leave most of the vegetation up, so that provides another good habitat source for things to lay their eggs in.
In this garden, the desire to support wildlife and increase biodiversity is far more important than neatness or orderly arrangements, resulting in a lovely rustic style.
It's not at all a question of untidiness. It's all very deliberate.
It is. It's very deliberate. This was Christo's style, and he wanted the garden to be much more relaxed and have this sort of private feel about it. And so we allow things to come up in the cracks in the paving. We allow plants to spill out onto the paving. We allow plants to invade your space as well. And so it gives the garden a charm, certain amount of romance, intimacy. Half the people who visit won't like that loose style. The other half will. So we're not there to please everybody, but we're there to be an individual.
There are other areas in the garden that, somewhat unexpectedly, are also teeming with life. The towering compost heaps provide another wildlife bonus.
I asked the British Arachnological Society to come and survey the insects that we've got. They came out here to look at the long grass, but then they found it quite interesting to look at the compost heaps, and they had these little pewters, and they went and started sucking out spiders to identify them, and they found dozens and dozens and dozens of species in here, and they were really so excited that they went to other parts of the garden. They found a little thing that lived under a paving slab that hadn't been recorded since 1903 or something crazy like that. You suddenly realise that you're sharing this garden with all these incredible insects and all sorts of things. Dexter is extraordinarily rich, you know, extraordinarily rich, which shows that an intensive garden, a colourful garden like this, that's gardened intensively, can be a safe haven for all this wildlife.
Fergus and his team have picked up the baton of Christo's pioneering ideas about ecology, and they've run with it. They've proved that biodiversity and beauty can, and do, work in harmony all year round. And while the garden itself is constantly evolving and transforming, it's the passion of its custodians that will never change. Winter in the garden is often misunderstood as a quiet season. At Great Dexter, this couldn't be further from the truth.
Winter's one of the busiest times of the year here at Great Dexter. For a start, there won't be any visitors in the garden until the end of March. And that means there are loads of opportunities for Fergus and his team to get on with all those important tasks that prepare the garden for the year ahead.
There's potting up to be done, and the herbaceous borders to be prepared.
And at this time of the year, one of the most important tasks is pruning, and there's plenty of that to do.
Earlier in the year, the old espaliered Brunswick fig against the wall in the barn garden was almost hidden behind its foliage. But now it shed all its leaves.
Okay, so if we went through and tipped all of this, we'd lose most of our fruit.
So this is the best time for Fergus to demonstrate how to prune and train it.
All right, so we're going to fan train it.
A job that's been done every year since it was planted in 1921.
I'm going to take that off there, leave a little sort of gap there so the plant can grow.
In winter, the evergreen hedges, the bones of the garden, really come into their own. As do the peacock topiaries near the front of the house, another iconic feature of this garden.
Winter's the very best time to appreciate the permanent features, the structure of the garden, like these astonishing peacocks. These peacocks were planted in about 1912. And Daisy, Christo's mother, used to refer to them as her parliament of birds. They've become iconic. If you know about Dexter, you almost certainly know about the peacocks.
Originally intended as topiary pheasants, fighting cocks and blackbirds, these days they're all referred to as peacocks. And there are 18 of them roosting in this area. Although the structure and hard lines of the garden are at their peak now, they're by no means the only thing on offer here in winter. Winter has descended on the garden at Great Dexter in the Sussex High Weald. Because the garden is officially closed until spring, I'm the only visitor today. This is a garden known for its succession planting, and that doesn't stop just because the gates are closed.
There are all sorts of secretive little corners at Dexter, and in the winter you're aware that lots of them are full of interest, full of all sorts of beautiful plants. Here, there's a carpet of cyclamen. This is Hederifolium, the ivy-leaved cyclamen. But as you look at each plant, everyone has its own kind of fingerprint. It's completely distinct. And one of the things that you're not aware of immediately is that the air here is just full of beautiful perfume.
All areas of the garden get extra care and attention in the winter, including the estate's woodlands. Here, sweet chestnut trees are cut down to ground level, known as coppicing, promoting vigorous regrowth. It's a traditional woodland practice that Fergus has reintroduced because it's excellent for biodiversity. It encourages more plant life, insects and mammals to call this area home. It also supplies the garden with sustainable timber. This is taken to one of the 500-year-old barns.
I love this building.
Where I'm meeting Fergus for the final time.
It's a medieval barn, you know. It's a wonderful structure.
So how old is it? Hundreds and hundreds.
15th century.
Yeah.
Traditionally, estates use the high volume of coppiced wood for everything, from firewood to furniture. Elsewhere, it's a dying practice, but one that Fergus has eagerly reinstated with the help of the garden's carpentry apprentices.
It really is a hive of activity.
This is all year that we're doing this.
Yeah.
And but it's you know, we're most active in the winter.
So there's this glorious sort of symbiosis between what's happening out there and what goes on here.
Today, the apprentices make all manner of beautifully handcrafted items, which are used all over the estate. Simon is going to show me how it's done.
So what's this tool called that you're using?
This is a draw knife. You're drawing it towards yourself.
And what are you making with it?
These are going to be rungs to go in a hurdle. So these are the miniature hurdles we make.
Yeah, I've seen them around the garden.
This device is the shaving horse.
Can I have a go?
Yeah, of course, yeah.
Oh, it's lovely. I don't think I'm very gliding, am I?
I don't know, it's really good.
Well, it's not quite there, is it? Doesn't live up to the perfection of that.
Oh, I don't know.
With a bit of practice.
They're all individuals, so. Yeah. I've got no favourites.
No, well, you're not giving us a job just yet.
Oh, I don't know. When can you start?
In winter, this garden is as exciting, dynamic, and challenging as it is at any other time of year. But with spring in the wings, the wildflower meadows will soon start to bloom and buzz with new life.
You can appreciate everything as it is, whatever the season, but you're also so aware of how it's going forward.
I love it at this time of year because you get rid of all that summer fluff and you're looking at all the bones of it. It's really exciting, the whole thing.
Yeah, isn't it?
This may be a garden that epitomises successional planting, but just as one type of flower succeeds another, so do the people as Fergus continues to embrace his important task of passing his ideas on to the next generation.
Well, here I am, back in the same spot again, and almost a whole year has gone by. And the more I've come to know the garden and know about it, the more convinced I am of how important it is. Which plants we grow, what we put together, the beauty of the garden. But on top of that, there's something much deeper. There's that whole ethos that's come to inform the way that we all garden.
My year at Great Dixter has been incredible, and all four seasons have been a delight in their own special ways, thanks to Fergus, Christo and their legacy. It's wonderful to see Christo's adventurous spirit living on through the passion of the people here, the respect for biodiversity, and yet still pushing the boundaries with experimentation. And that's what makes Great Dixter one of Britain's best gardens.